Welcome to Soil Sessions, a webinar series by the Soil Health Partnership. At this time, I would like to introduce our host, Aaron Brooker, Research Fellow for SHP, to start this soil session.
Thank you, Stacy. Thank you, everybody, for being here. Like Stacy said, my name is Aaron Brooker, and I am working with SHP as a research fellow. And today I'm going to be talking about interseeding cover crops in corn. And this is research I just finished up as part of my Ph.D. program at Michigan State University. And I'm just going to start by recognizing the funding sources that made all of this work possible. We had three different grants that helped to fund this research, and we're really thankful for the support that these groups have provided to this research, as it's really important for advancing soil health. So to give you a little bit of background on previous interseeding research, there's been a lot of research. Previously, 20 years ago or more, interseeding research was pretty common, but it kind of died off, and then it's reemerged as we've had better interseeding technologies to get the cover crops into the corn, and then different herbicide technologies that have come over the years as well. This previous research that's been conducted more recently has shown that there's been no yield reductions when seeded after the V5 corn growth stage, and up to about the V7 or V8 growth stages is when most of these interseeding researchers have interseeded. Annual ryegrass, crimson clover, and red clovers have been really popular species in this research, while oilseed radish and brassica species have been rarely evaluated. They've been in a couple of studies, but not very many. And then there's been mixtures of grasses and clovers, and sometimes these brassica species, but there's not been research that's conducted, looked at a mixture of all three of these species, which we tried to do. To give you a little bit of background on cover crop use in Michigan, it's fairly limited due to our climate and the crops we grow. Red clover is often frost seeded into wheat in the spring. Cereal rye is seeded after corn and soybean harvest. Even this, the establishment can sometimes be limited if it's a really harsh early winter. And then brassica and or grass cover crops can be seeded after wheat and many of the vegetable crops that we grow. So to give you an outline of what I'm going to be talking about, we conducted two different experiments. The first experiment was from 2015 to 2018. And in this experiment, we looked at the timing of interseeding and what species we could use, the soil health impacts of interseeded cover crops after 1 year of interseeding, and then cover crop tolerance to residual herbicides used in corn. In the second experiment from 2017, and we'll be continuing through 2020, we looked at the same interseeded cover crop species, but we wanted to see the effects of different seeding rates on corn. We used remote sensing to assess cover crop establishment and corn health. And then we also wanted to look more in depth at the cover crop effects on soil health, soil structure, and nutrient cycling, and the effects not only after 1 year of interseeding, but after 2 years of interseeding as well. So our objectives were to determine which cover crop species can establish when broadcast interseeded in corn, determine when cover crops can be interseeded at the early corn growth stages, determine if cover crops compete with the corn when broadcast interseeded at these growth stages, determine the soil health benefits from interseeding cover crops in corn, and then again to evaluate those pre and post-emergence herbicide options. So first, looking at interseeding timing and species selection. So this was all small plot research conducted at two different experiment stations that are part of Michigan State University. This was conducted from 2015 to 2017 again. And the species we used, the single species, were annual ryegrass, oilseed radish, and crimson clover at 16, 18, and 16 pounds per acre, respectively. And then we also included a mixture of the three species. And this was a commercially available mixture, and it included 10 pounds of annual ryegrass and 2 pounds each of oilseed radish and crimson clover. For the interseeding timings we looked at B1 through B7, each of these timings, and we applied glyphosate prior to each interseeding timing to control any weeds that were present. Now, glyphosate isn't a residual herbicide, so any weeds emerging afterwards were subject to compete with the corn or compete with the cover crops or both. So we weren't able to control those weeds in this experiment. Basically, for data collection, we looked at establishment 30 days after interseeding, and then we looked at cover crop biomass and weed biomass at corn harvest and also in the spring. And then we also collected corn grain yield. Moving into some of these results, looking at cover crop density combined over the 4 site years, we can see that for annual ryegrass, looking from the V2 through V7 interseeding timings here on the left, you can see that the V4 and through V7 timings had the greatest emergence of this cover crop. Similarly, with crimson clover, we also saw that the V5 and V7 timings, so those later timings again, had better cover crop emergence. And there were no difference in oilseed radish. Again, this is looking at 30 days after interseeding. So when we look at our October measurements, we saw that, again, later interseeding timings were somewhat more favorable for the number of cover crop plants that established, with annual ryegrass being highest at V7 and crimson clover being highest at V4, V5, and V7. And again, oilseed radish, we didn't see a lot of difference. Looking at cover crop biomass, so basically the biomass was greatest at the V2 interseeding at around 220 pounds per acre. Now keep in mind, we harvested this before we removed the corn, so there could be potential for greater biomass accumulation in the month of October and on into November before we get our first freeze. But one thing I'll point out is that even though we saw higher plant densities at those later interseeding timings, our biomass was greatest at the V2 interseeding. So we think that by interseeding earlier, these cover crops had more time to accumulate biomass before the corn canopy closed over them. And so despite having fewer plants, there was more biomass. And then looking at the cover crop species, annual ryegrass produced the most fall biomass and crimson clover produced the least. And you can see that in these pictures, with annual ryegrass and tillage radish looking pretty good, and then there's not much crimson clover to see. Moving into the spring, we measured these usually in April, but it depended on the spring when we got warmer temperatures. Annual ryegrass again produced the most biomass, but this wasn't surprising because oilseed radish doesn't overwinter in Michigan, and then crimson clover usually didn't overwinter in our experiments, though it can overwinter if we do have a milder winter. So to summarize, cover crops will establish when interseeded from B1 to V7. One thing you might have noticed is that I didn't include some of the V1 results in that experiment when I was going over the results. And that was because when we interseeded at V1, we just had too many weeds and they competed with the corn, they competed with the cover crops. And so we just had a lot of weed biomass, and that really showed us the importance that we need to control weeds in this experiment. And then annual ryegrass and oilseed radish again outperformed crimson clover. Moving on to soil nitrogen cycling and some soil health indicators. So this experiment, we used the same cover crop experiment that we had before. What we did was sample soils in the spring in April from the V1, V3, and V5 plots. And we wanted to look for inorganic nitrogen, which is NH4 or ammonium, and NO3, which is nitrate. We also looked at extracellular enzymes and soil aggregation. Additionally, we planted corn as an indicator crop to determine if we were seeing any impacts of these cover crops on a successive crop. And we did not fertilize this crop with nitrogen to determine if there were any nitrogen cycling effects on that corn crop. So for anybody that's not familiar with soil extracellular enzymes, basically microbes produce enzymes to break down organic material and other materials in the soil in an attempt to acquire nutrients and energy, which is in the form of carbon. The amount of enzyme activity in a soil sample soil is an indication of a couple of different things. It could be that there are just a large amount of microbes present if you have large enzyme activity, or it could be a sign of nutrient or energy limitations. Right now, the research points to that microbes will spend more energy to gather a nutrient that is limiting. So if nitrogen is limiting in the soil, a microbe might produce more enzymes to acquire nitrogen. And then how we measure this, we basically sample a soil, we add a substrate or a nutrient to that soil and measure the amount of enzyme activity as an indication of the amount of microbes that were present or if there were nutrient limitations. And to look at the nitrogen cycle really quick, I'm gonna go briefly over this, but basically plants and organic matter contain nitrogen. Microbes can break it down through mineralization into NH4, and then through nitrification, we get our NO3. Now, NH4 is fairly stable in the soil compared with NO3, nitrate, which is subject to leaching and denitrification. So this is the form of nitrogen that we can lose easily from the soil, but it's also the form that's most easily taken up by plants. So we want to have a balance of not having too much nitrate that it's lost, but also want it to be available to the plants. Now, looking more closely at these, basically, if when we sampled these soils in the spring, if nitrate is high, farmers could lose that nitrogen from the soil if we get a lot of rain or if conditions are favorable for denitrification. When cover crops are present in the spring, much of that N could be contained within the cover crop biomass and not subject to loss. And then that nitrogen could be supplied to the following crop after we terminate a cover crop. So looking at some of the results from this. So first, soil inorganic nitrogen was reduced where annual ryegrass was interseeded at one location only. So you can see in this graph, looking at our combined inorganic nitrogen here, you can see that at annual ryegrass plots where they were sampled had lower total inorganic nitrogen. And that's not surprising because if you remember, annual ryegrass was the only cover crop that overwintered successfully in this experiment. Looking at the other two sites, you can see that annual ryegrass was lower, but it wasn't a significant difference, but we're still seeing that trend. Now, remember I said we planted a corn crop again to determine if this nitrogen difference had any impact on a corn crop. And at one location, we potentially saw that nitrogen was maybe limited where annual ryegrass was interseeded. So maybe the timing of termination wasn't right or something didn't quite work out right that we may have been limiting nitrogen. And that's seen through a higher carbon to nitrogen ratio. With higher carbon to nitrogen ratios, that means the carbon is going to stay fairly similar in a corn plant, but if there's less nitrogen available, then that will be a higher C to N ratio and vice versa. Now, we did only see that significant impact in 1 year, and we didn't see that in two of the other years. Looking at soil aggregation, this is measured in mean weight diameter in this study, and basically that means the average size of soil particles that we sampled. There was not much of a difference comparing these three sites or cover crop species or interseeding timings. So basically we didn't see much difference in this and think that this is something that with, as with many soil health indicators, it's going to be something that changes more over time So it didn't surprise us that this didn't change after only 1 year of interseeding. Looking at our extracellular enzymes, we saw kind of the same story as with our aggregation. There were large differences between our sites, but these differences were not impacted by cover crop species or interseeding timings. And again, we just expect that this is because of only 1 year of interseeding, and that with multiple years of interseeding or different types of cover crop use, maybe we'll see differences in enzyme activity and therefore microbial activity. So to summarize, overwintering annual ryegrass had the potential to reduce soil inorganic nitrogen, and then this could increase corn seed to N ratio, but that could be based on timing of termination and other factors. Changes in soil aggregation and extracellular enzyme activity are more likely to be seen over longer periods, so it wasn't surprising that we had a lack of significant results in our experiment. So now I'm going to move on to that second experiment that I talked about in the beginning of my presentation, where we wanted to look at different seeding rates, remote sensing, and soil health. For this experiment, we had our same two experimental locations at Michigan State, and we also included different on-farm locations throughout the state of Michigan that gave us somewhat of a representation of the corn-growing regions in the state. We looked at fairly similar rates that we used in the original experiment for our 1x seeding rate. And we also included a 1/2x seeding rate and a 2x seeding rate to see if we saw any differences in competition with corn or interspecific competition where we had cover crops competing with each other. Additionally, in the mixture, we found that annual ryegrass dominated the previous mixture, and this was also seen in the scientific literature. And probably some of you that have experimented with mixtures know that annual ryegrass or other grasses can really take over a mixture if they're seeded at too high of a rate. So we dropped the rate of annual ryegrass and only used crimson clover as another species and looked at a two-species mixture. For this experiment, this slide is not correct here, but the V3 and V6 interseeding timings were the only ones we looked at for this experiment. And then different interseeders that we used throughout both experiments. For the small plot research, I used small hand spreaders, but more interseeder technologies, we used these for the on-farm experiments. And so anything from a 6-row interseeder, as you can see here, up to this modified sprayer, which this one did 36 rows at a time. We also had a farmer that was interseeding 40 rows at a time. So we've got some farmers really interested in this practice and building their own seeders, but there's not a lot of research backing up which species to use and seeding rates and things like that. So the methods were pretty similar to the first experiment that we used. The one difference is that we did this for 2 years. So we did the initial year, and then we went back in, planted corn, and planted the same cover crops in the same plots again to get 2 years of interseeding data. The other difference is that we did control the weeds in this experiment. And this was through hand weeding these plots on the small plot trials. We did not control weeds on the on-farm locations. So I'm going to first talk about some of the on-farm strip trial results. And just going to talk about cover crop biomass. So first in these figures, you'll see that we have 2017 and 2018 results. And looking at these locations and these pie charts, the overall size of the pie chart is the proportional to the overall cover crop biomass that was produced at that site, combining the three species. Within each pie chart, we have annual ryegrass in white, crimson clover in light gray, and oilseed radish in the dark gray. And the size of the slices are proportional to the amount of biomass that each of those produced relative to each other. So you can see that in 2017, this B site in northern Michigan produced the most biomass of any of our locations, with the E site slightly behind it. And it was pretty variable which cover crop species did the best. But oilseed radish always performed very well. Sometimes ryegrass did well, sometimes crimson clover did well. It was just variable depending on our sites. One thing we did notice is that sites where we had tilled fields before we interseeded, we tended to get higher emergence and higher biomass production. One reason for this, we think, is that tillage creates cracks in the soil, and when we're broadcast interseeding, we get better seed to soil contact, especially if we're in a low rainfall situation or something like that. Additionally, another thing we think is going on, in this green box, you can see that higher PAR, which is photosynthetically active radiation, so the light that plants are using to photosynthesize, we think that the light reaching the cover crops was higher when we had lower planting populations and lower yielding corn. So lower planting populations are often seen in some of our sandier soils. And additionally, lower yielding corn might be seen in a northern site. And visually, we can see this when we have smaller corn plants and more light able to penetrate the corn canopy. So to summarize, cover crops established both at the V3 and V6 growth stages. We already knew that from the previous experiment. Annual ryegrass usually had the highest density again, but oilseed radish biomass was always equal to or greater than the other two cover crop species. Higher rainfall, we saw higher rainfall in 2017, and that's why in those charts you saw that generally 2017 had higher biomass compared with 2018. And then we think that tillage improved establishment, especially when we had below normal rainfall. And we've seen this in some of our other experiments that we get a lot of differences in emergence and establishment and biomass production when we have low rainfall. When we have really consistent high amounts of rainfall, pretty much everything will establish. All three cover crop species have the potential to do well in that kind of a situation, but that's not the reality all the time. Looking at our different seeding rates, and this was on the small plot research only, I'm just going to show some pictures of what we saw. Annual ryegrass at the 2x seeding rate is here on the left and at the 1x seeding rate on the right, and you can see that it did produce somewhat more biomass. And the same can be seen with tillage radish at the 2x and the 1x seeding rates as well. When we look at crimson clover, kind of as we saw in the first experiment, we didn't really see this effect as crimson clover didn't establish very well in some of these experiments. One thing I will say is that in this year, 2019, we had a lot more consistent rainfall and generally just a lot more rainfall, and crimson clover actually did pretty well. Now looking at corn grain yield, all cover crops in this experiment were able to produce kind of a maximum of 535 pounds per acre of fall biomass for all three species. And at that rate, nothing competed with the corn. Now, in isolated situations, oilseed radish produced up to 4,000 or 3,500 pounds per acre of biomass, and that still wasn't competitive with corn. So to summarize, cover crop density and biomass generally increased with increasing seeding rates. Average or above average rainfall within 30 days of interseeding improves establishment regardless of interseeding timing. So we don't think there's much benefit of a V3 or a V6 timing other than when the rainfall occurs to get establishment. And then cover crops did not reduce corn grain yield at any of the seeding rates we used, and cover crops did not suppress winter annual weeds. So moving on to the weed control aspect of this experiment, we wanted to know if pre and post emergence herbicides could be used when interseeding cover crops. This is a long list of the herbicides that we used pretty much encompassing any pre- and post-emergence herbicide that a farmer in Michigan might use on their corn. I'll just point out that these colors are based on the site of action colors by Take Action on Weeds. There's a website for that. I'll be using these colors throughout this section of the experiment as I reference the different herbicides. And our pre-herbicides were applied the day of corn planting, and our post-herbicides were applied just prior to our V3 interseeding. And again, sorry this slide isn't updated. We did just seed at the V3 and V6 interseeding timings at this experiment as well. So looking at some of the results, we have in this graph stand reduction on this y-axis, and then all of our cover or all of our herbicides that we used. So basically, this is stand reduction compared to an untreated control. And so high bars mean that we had high stand reduction, and low bars mean low stand reduction and potentially herbicides that were safe to use. So this is annual ryegrass seeded at V3 and V6. So we combine that data looking at pre-herbicides only. And you can see that our group 15 herbicides, which are known for having good grass weed control, were also unsafe to seed annual ryegrass. But we did see that there were some safe options for seeding annual ryegrass. Conversely, with oilseed radish, we split up the V3 and V6 interseeding timings. At the V3 interseeding timing, we had high stand reduction from flumetzalam, rimsulfuron, your group 2 herbicides, a couple of our group 15 herbicides, and one of our group 27 HPPD herbicides. Now, when we moved to V6, we still had high stand reduction from our group 2s, but we see that there's a little bit of reduced stand reduction when we look at our group 15s and the group 27 mesotrione. So you can see that there could be a case for interseeding later after that herbicide application to let some of that herbicide activity dissipate and allow for our cover crops to grow. Moving on to our post-emergence herbicides, I'm not going to read through all of this. You can look through some of these if you're interested while I'm talking about this slide. But what I want to point out is that if you, for instance, wanted to seed a single species like annual ryegrass, you can see you have a few post-emergence herbicide options and a couple at 26% stand reduction, 23%. That might cause some stand reduction, but not a lot. Same with oilseed radish, there are some options. Now, if you think about seeding a mix of these two species, you can see that it becomes much more difficult. You have, according to this chart, three options that would be totally safe and a couple of potential options that might be somewhat safe for both species. But it gets really hard to seed a mixture of cover crops when you're applying a residual herbicide, is the point that I'd like to make on this graph. So basically summarizing these are just from the graphs that I just saw or just showed you, but cover crops can be interseeded following pre-herbicides. You just have to be really careful about your species selection, and the same with post-herbicides. And one last thing that I'll point out on this is that even though we saw that you could seed a cover crop safely after some of these, there could still be label restrictions on seeding that cover crop. So make sure on your label that you can interseed that cover crop based on what's allowed from the label. So to summarize all of this, again, looking at our cover crop species, annual ryegrass and oilseed radish generally outperformed our crimson clover. But as I said, crimson clover established well when rainfall was above normal. We especially saw this year. We also saw it in 2015. So in a state where you might get more consistent rainfall, crimson clover could be a good option. In Michigan, our rainfall is really dependent on the lakes and the directions of the storms coming in. And so we do have a little bit more variable rainfall than some other states in the region. For interseeding timing, cover crops can be interseeded at any of the V2 through V7 stages, but we do need to control weeds in order to prevent competition with corn. And again, there are pre and post herbicide options, but you just need to pay special attention to what cover crop you want to use and what herbicides you're using. And especially if you want to interseed a mixture, your herbicide options can become pretty limited. Looking at weed suppression, I didn't talk specifically about this, but basically cover crops really didn't suppress summer annual weeds. So those weeds that are coming up with the cover crops, we just didn't see any ability of the cover crops to suppress those. Annual ryegrass sometimes provided winter annual weed suppression, but this effect wasn't consistent, and we think we need more consistent biomass production to suppress those winter annual weeds. For our seeding rates, increasing seeding rates resulted in higher fall biomass production. This wasn't surprising, but seeding costs can get pretty high, and as you saw with some of those seeding rates, some of them just aren't really practical, but what we were looking for was competition with corn and just giving you an idea of what that would look like. To look more specifically at seeding costs, you can see here for all of our three species, for instance, at a 2x seeding rate, you could get up into the 30s and even $40 per acre for seeding some of these. And farmers just aren't going to do that. So we're going to be looking at these half and 1x rates more realistically. Looking at nutrient cycling and our soil health indicators, cover crops really had minimal effects on our soil health indicators after only 1 year of interseeding. We are doing more work with this project that has 2 years of interseeding to see if we see more effects, but some of that's not done yet. And then we do see some effects on soil nitrogen cycling, especially with our annual ryegrass plots where annual ryegrass overwinters. And one last thing that I didn't talk much about that was a large part of the project was remote sensing. Basically, with remote sensing, we are able to see cover crops emerging before the canopy closure covers those up. So it could be a useful tool to assess cover crop establishment, and we already know that it can be a useful tool to assess corn health. And so since we didn't see any effects on corn yield, remote sensing also didn't see any effects on corn health, but it's still a really useful tool in situations where you do have differing soil types or differing nutrient statuses or disease issues throughout the field. So remote sensing still is a very powerful tool, even though our cover crops didn't compete, and so we didn't see that impact. And with that, I'd like to thank you for listening.